So, you've decided to make a Half-Life map. Well, you've come to the right place. Maybe it's not necessarily for Half-Life, it could be Counter-Strike, Sven Co-op, or something else really, but I mean, you're still in the right place. Anyway, before we start, let me introduce myself and the series. I'm Admir, and I've been mapping for 10 years now, and I'm going to share with you all my secrets. In this first video, we're going to learn some basic concepts about mapping, and then we're going to make a really basic room with a player spawn and a light source in it. We're not going to load into Half-Life just yet. That's going to be in the next video, because there's a bunch of stuff that can go wrong with that. Exporting the map to the engine, you can have a bunch of errors, so I want to make a dedicated video just for that. So I decided to start this series as like some kind of supplement to all of the existing ones out there. You got Dimbeek's mapping series, Lymphoid series, and a few others. But I feel that there's, something maybe missing and that I could fill it in. And you'll see what I mean. So basically, I structured this series into skill chapters A, B, C, and Pro. The A skill is all about the basics. You're gonna learn how to do some really basic things that, in my opinion, every mapper should know by heart. The B series is more intermediate stuff, C is pretty advanced stuff, and the Pro chapter is, well, beyond just gold source mapping. It's about level design in general, working with multiple people on the project, stuff like that. So, what is a map? Like, what is a map? Well, it's just a file. It's a .bsp file sitting in the game's maps folder. It's a binary file, so unfortunately you can't really just open this up in Notepad and edit it. Technically, there's a way to directly edit these BSP files, but that's a story for another time. How do you make a map then? Well, it's pretty simple. You make a .map file in a level editor, and using some special tools, you create a .bsp out of it. In a typical level editor, you work primarily with two things: brushes and entities. Simply put, brushes are little shapes that you construct a map with. Kind of like Lego bricks, except unlike Lego bricks, these can be of any shape, so long as they follow certain rules. We're not going to get too technical here. I'm going to explain those rules in the next video. Now, entities. Oh boy, there's two kinds of entities. There's point entities and solid, aka brush entities. Point entities are stuff like player spawns, lights, NPCs, weapons, and so on. Brush entities tend to be moving objects and breakable walls and triggers and so on. Now, one cool thing about entities, and this is common to all of them, is that they have the ability to target each other and cause their targets to perform an action. This is called triggering. A player might press a button, and said button would call the elevator. Very simple stuff, but it can be used to make pretty advanced contraptions, game modes even. Now that you have a very rough idea of what a map is made of and how some things should behave, let's actually talk about level editors. So right now in the Gold Source community, there's two major players, I would say. There's Jack and there's Trenchbroom. Both are community made, and Jack is basically just a modern version of Hammer. There's still some people who use Hammer nowadays, but Jack is basically the de facto Gold Source map editor these days. Trenchbroom is much less popular here, as in the Gold Source community, but it dominates the Quake modding community because it does certain things really well. So I've been wondering, like, which one should I focus on? But honestly, I'm just gonna cover both. I don't care. Since you're a beginner, a complete beginner probably, I'd like you to see the workflow of both of these map editors so that you can see which one of them you like more or you think you're gonna like more. So with that said, let's set up Jack. You can get it for free on ModDB or its official website. If you want it to have Steam achievements, you can buy it on Steam. If you're using the free version, I would recommend you to install it somewhere outside of program files, because some people reported that their settings don't get saved if it's there. It's some issue with permissions and security on Windows. So, yeah, I, for example, install it in D/Jack. So that's one way to do it. Once Jack is installed, you can enter it and behold, the Hammer style user interface. You got these tools to the left, all these mini tools up above, but we can't use them just yet. They're grayed out. Well, that's because we don't have a map yet, and we can't because we don't have a game configuration. So you're going to go to Tools and then Options, or just hit F2. That's another way to do it. You're going to land on the General Settings page. We are interested in the game configs, so go there. You're going to create a new game config and name it whatever you want. I usually go for the name of the game or a mod, and maybe a word that helps describe the variant of it, just to differentiate, for example, between WAN and Steam Half-Life. Alright, so the first thing you're going to do is add the FGD files. These are text files, you can open them up with Notepad or whatever, and they contain descriptions of all the different entities in the game. So, for example, we can see that Funk Breakable is a solid class, it has a health property, it has different materials, like, yo, isn't that kinda awesome? Like, all of this stuff can be controlled by you, the level designer. Anyway, you might wanna set your default point entity to Info Player Start, and your default brush entity to Funk Wall, or maybe Funk Breakable. I don't know, I personally go for that because I like breaking stuff, you know? Now, that's about it for the entities. Let's go to the directories tab. So here you just list paths to the game. Game executable points to hl.exe. This way, Jack can automatically launch the game once you actually export it. Or, well, to be more precise, once you build the map. Exporting and compiling are two different things we're going to talk about in the next video, but base game directory is where all of the game files are. This is going to be Valve. So not just Valve, but like the full path to Valve. And mod directory is for mods. If you're mapping for Counter-Strike, this field would be C-Strike, so that any file that is missing from C-Strike would be looked for in Valve. Lastly, source maps directory is where your map projects are going to be saved. It has nothing to do with the source engine, by the way. This can be anywhere, and I prefer it to be a completely independent place from the game, somewhere in my work folders, for example. But that's up to you, really. And lastly, for now, textures. The Gold Source engine uses WAD files to store textures in them, alright? So one WAD file can contain a ton of textures. You may also want to add Xeno, liquids, and decals. Yes, decals, like things like bullet holes, scratches, dirt layers, and so on. You know, stuff like that is a nice touch, you know. We're not going to touch build programs for now. Those are going to be in the next video. All right, epic. So let's create a brand new map. Go to File, New, and if you have multiple game configs, it's going to ask you which one you want. If not, it's going to skip that. It's going to choose the only one that you have. It's going to ask you to input the dimensions of a room, and like, honestly, just cancel that. We're going to build a room by ourselves. So first, you might want to move around a little bit, you know, in this 3D space, which doesn't really exist yet, there's nothing in it. But anyway, put your mouse cursor into the 3D view over here, so it has to be within this rectangle, and then press Z. You can now use the mouse look, you can now use WASD, you can move around, basically. And eventually you should see the three world axes, that is X, Y, and Z, as well as your camera in the 2D views. Now let's select a little texture for a start. So go to the texture thingy here and click Browse, and then find whatever you think is a generic texture that can go just about anywhere. Now click on the brush tool, or Shift B if you will, and drag out a rectangle in the top view, and then press Enter when you're happy. Me personally, I'm never happy, but you know how life goes. And would you know it? You've made your first brush ever, at least I hope. Now, I want you to get used to this motion, develop some muscle memory. So, you know, press Shift B, drag a rectangle, hit Enter, and then maybe Shift S, or just repeat the whole procedure. You're going to be very slow at this at first, but I promise you, within a few weeks, you're going to be pretty fast at it. Maybe not fast, but you're going to be pretty okay at it, and you're going to be able to make some stuff, if you practice, of course. Now, let's do the same thing for the walls, but instead of using the brush tool, we're going to use the select tool, Shift S. Click on the brush in 3D, and then copy-paste the brush into 2D view. Alternatively, you can hold down Shift while dragging the thing. Anyway, now let's place a light and a player spawn inside. So use the Entity tool, or Shift-E, and click on the floor in 3D. Voila! We got Gordon Freeman here. You can also check out some other entities and place down, like, some weapons, lights, monsters, and stuff, you know. And that's about it for Jack. Like, you've basically completed basic training for Jack, that is. so you can find Trench Room on GitHub in the releases section. The latest version right now is 2024.1, and I'm going to download Win64 because I'm on a 64-bit Windows. I'm going to extract it somewhere into like /TrenchRoom2024. You can do whatever you want, just please don't be that person who dumps everything onto the desktop. I beg of you. Now, compared to Jack, Trench Room is a little different. When you launch it, you're greeted by a recent maps menu, and if you go to new map, you're gonna see that it asks which game are you gonna choose. This is a bit like Jack, well, kind of reminiscent of it. However, you gotta open the preferences here and go to Half-Life. Instead of filling out just, you know, this base game directory and then the mod directory and all that other stuff, here you just give it one path that is to the Half-Life installation. So not the Half-Life .exe, just the folder it's in, alright? And that's it. Simple as pie. If you're coming from Jack, you might wonder where the FGD is at, and there are already a few that come with Trench Room, and they're automatically used. They're called built-in FGDs, and you can find them down here. Anyway, let's go into a new map and make a room again. Yay, so make sure the map format is set to Valve and press OK. You'll see that initially the layout is a little reminiscent of Jack. You know, you got this massive 3D view here, you got these mini tools up here, a console log down there. But let me tell you, like, honestly, this tool, it's a completely different beast to Jack, and let me show you why. So first, let's select a WAD. So you're gonna go to the Entity tab and notice the WAD field. Click on that, fiddle around with the collapsible menus until you get the WAD file list, and click on a wee little plus icon and add Half-Life.wad. I would recommend selecting relative to game directory whenever possible, and absolute only if that option is not available. Now that you have some WADs, let's actually go to the face tab and do the same thing as before, that is, find a nice texture. Now select the brush and then select the texture in order to apply it. Great. Now the real fun part. So in Trench Room, you move around by holding the right mouse button and WASD. You can also use a scroll wheel to adjust your speed while moving. Now just follow me here. Hold down Shift and place your mouse somewhere in front of the brush. You'll see that a face gets highlighted. So just go ahead and drag it out. Click and hold and then move your mouse. As you can see, this extends the brush along its face, and that's pretty cool. Now hold down Control and drag the brush. You can see that the brush is now duplicated, a bit like Shift and dragging in Jack, except here we hold down Shift to actually shape the brush a little bit. We're gonna do the same for the other sides. Now that you've done that, select all of those four sides by Control-clicking and then hold down Alt to move them vertically. Then extrude them vertically again and similarly clone the floor and move it up to make a ceiling. That's basically it. Now just to revise, Control-drag duplicates, Shift-drag extends, and Alt moves vertically. Remember that. As you can see, Trench Room is more shortcut-oriented than, say, Jack. And I guess it's a bit like Blender in that regard. It's got like fairly small shortcuts, which are used very often. And don't worry if this seems complex or tedious. Truth is, every tool is like that. You just gotta get used to it, you know, you just gotta develop some muscle memory, you know? Now, don't forget to press Escape to deselect everything now. Finally, adding entities is as simple as right-clicking on the floor and going to Create Point Entity and then selecting Info Player Start. So, what's next? Well, my advice to you is go everywhere you can, like watch Dimbeek's mapping series, watch Lymphoid series, watch Dumbtruck DS's Trench Room tutorials, even if they're for Quake. Like, watch as much stuff as you can. You know, seeing all of the different approaches can either inspire you or give you a headache. Or both. Then you know it's a good tutorial. Now, I would also recommend you to read some written tutorials. You know, the whole Half-Life has a wealth of information out there, and there's some gems maybe on Game Banana and ModDB. Seek knowledge and you shall find it. Also, don't just rely on tutorials and other people, like, look around, click around, see what each tool does. You know, like Jack and Trench Room, they both have manuals, and you should definitely read them, you know? And as always, all links are in the description. Anyway, throughout the whole beginner chapter, there's going to be examples in both Jack and Trench Broom. As we move on from learning the tools to learning concepts, designs, principles, and so on, the map editors are going to be mixed. Like, at some point you're going to see Jack, at some point you're going to see Trench Broom, and I think there's going to be a nice little balance there. I will admit, doing this initially, like, together bloats the video up a little bit, but honestly I think there's enough value to justify it. In the next video, we're going to see how to actually compile these maps so that Half-Life can open them, and we're going to learn some basic troubleshooting. In the third video, we're going to start playing around with some basic shapes, creating tunnels, hallways, barrels, and that sort of stuff. It's going to be very fun. Thank you for your time, and until then, happy... mapping? Yeah, happy mapping.